Right, so today I figured we'd go back to Azure Basics and discuss regions and data centers. And then we'll kind of build from there and cover things like region pairs, availability zones, and of course, how all of these are related to each other. And when discussing these things, I guess it also makes sense to mention a couple of availability options that you may have noticed when you've been deploying stuff in Azure, but perhaps haven't offered much thought. I'm talking about LRS, ZRS, GRS, and so on. Curious about what they all mean? Well, let's get to it then. So let us start this journey at probably the first thing you will encounter when starting out with Azure, regions. These are often referred to as data centers, but that is actually wrong because a region will consist of multiple data centers. But I do understand why people still refer to regions as data centers, because data center, that's a term that most people have some sort of, I don't know, acquaintance with. But a region in Azure terms is what you select when deploying services. So I guess that's another reason why people refer to them as data centers. An Azure region consists of at least two data centers that are deployed within a latency-defined perimeter. What does that mean, you ask? Well, that means that any given Azure region does have at least two separate physical data centers that are totally independent of each other, meaning that they have their own power, cooling, networking, and so on, but they are connected to each other by means of a low latency link. I believe the requirement is for that link to be 2 milliseconds or below, so pretty low latency, but still noticeable if you are dealing with systems that are dependent on low latencies. It is also worth noting that there is no requirement for the data centers to be geographically separated. A common thing to do when you are setting up your own data center is to have them be X amount of kilometers apart to provide geo-redundancy, meaning in cases of fires, earthquakes, floods, and so on, that would hopefully only affect the one data center and leave the other one intact and still working. But since Azure data centers are only required to be independent of each other, they can be pretty close to each other physically. They can actually be located within the one and same building, as long as all the other requirements around cooling, power, and so on are in place. So if you need geo-redundancy, you would also need to consider region pairs. More on that later on. Moving on from regions and data centers, we have something that is closely related: availability zones, not to be confused with availability sets. Availability zones is something that a lot of Azure regions have, but not all. Like I mentioned, there is a requirement for Azure regions to have at least two data centers, but for a region to be availability zone enabled, it needs to have at least three data centers, so that they can provide those three availability zones. So each availability zone will consist of at least one data center, and then each availability zone needs to be connected to each other through a low latency link. Here it is a requirement that the round trip latency should be less than 2 milliseconds. And these connections should also be diverse fiber paths. If you're unfamiliar with the term diversity in regards to such connections, it just means that the physical cables should not enter the building on the same side, or at least not be put in the same ditch. So if one of those fiber connections enters on the east side of the building, the other one would typically enter on the west side. Using availability zones will provide you with greater resiliency in your environment, since you can build your services in one zone and then duplicate the setup in another zone. If then something should happen to one of the data centers, you will still have the setup running in that other zone. I would not recommend you think of this kind of setup as having disaster recovery though. For that, I would make use of region pairs, which I promise we'll get to in a minute. Now, not all services in Azure actually support availability zones, but those that do, they can be configured in two ways. You have zone redundant or zonal. Zone redundant means that they are automatically replicated across zones, while zonal means that they are configured to use a specific zone. Virtual machines is a simple example of a zonal service, where you select which availability zones you want to deploy to. So if you're setting up a simple service consisting of just two VMs, you would place one of them in zone 1 and the other in zone 2. If then something happens to the data center, which makes up availability zone 1, you would still have the VM running in zone 2. When using availability zones and multiple Azure subscription, there is one very important thing to remember. Availability zone 1 in subscription A is not necessarily backed by the same data center as availability zone 1 in subscription B. The reason for this is that the availability zones are mapped to data centers at the time of subscription creation. Now, this might not seem too important, but consider this scenario. You're building a solution that is meant to be highly resilient and thus want to make use of availability zones. So you create a subscription for side A of the solution and build side A in availability zone 1. You then create another subscription for side B and you build side B in availability zone 2. Since then side A and side B are in different subscriptions, you can end up in a situation where both side A and side B are backed by the same data center, losing you that extra resiliency that availability zones provide. There are ways to figure out if availability zones in different subscriptions map to the same data centers or not. It's just a bit finicky, so for now just keep this in the back of your head. Moving on, time to talk about those region pairs. To put it quite simple, region pairs are just two regions that are best buddies. Which regions that are buddies are set by Microsoft, and there is actually a list that you can find over on Learn. Link is of course down in the description. But the buddy of one region is basically just the region to which geo-redundant services are replicated. So if you, for example, have a storage account in West Europe that is set to be geo-redundant, then the data in that storage is replicated to West Europe's buddy, which would be North Europe. And speaking of geo-redundant services, those are usually indicated by the abbreviation GRS or some variant of it. And that brings us to those availability abbreviations. I mentioned in the intro LRS, ZRS, and GRS, so let's cover what those mean and what you need to keep in mind when selecting one or the other. These abbreviations are almost exclusively used when talking about data storage and the durability of your data, but they also impact availability, SLA, and of course, cost. Let's start with the lowest level of availability, the LRS. It stands for locally redundant storage, and this means that your data is only stored within one single data center. Remember the difference between zones, data centers, and regions? And while it is only stored in one data center, it is replicated 3 times within that single data center. This gives you a durability of 99.999999999% over a given year. That should be 11 nines there, but I didn't actually count. But keep in mind that this is durability. It doesn't say anything about the availability of your data. So you might end up in a scenario where you cannot access your data, it isn't available to you, but it does still exist. Also worth mentioning that those 3 copies of your data is written synchronously, so it's not considered a write success before all 3 are written. Next step up from LRS is ZRS, or Zone Redundant Storage. This means that your data will be stored across availability zones, 1 copy in each zone to be exact, meaning that an entire data center can be lost without any impact to your data or your access to it. This gives you another 9 in your durability, meaning you have 99 points and then 12 nines. Zone redundant storage is the recommended level for most workloads, including both Azure files and managed disks. Also, the 3 copies in a zone redundant storage is also written synchronously, like with LRS. If we go another step up, we reach the GRS or ra-grs levels. These are geo-redundant storage and read-access geo-redundant storage, respectively. When you select GRS as the availability level, you will get an additional 3 copies of your data, and those additional 3 are stored in another region, which, if you recall, would be the region pair or the best buddy of your primary region. You cannot select which region, Microsoft will use whatever region is the best buddy of your selected primary region. Now, if you have a storage account, for example, that is set to be GRS, then that storage account will be accessible from the primary region, but not from the secondary region. It will only be accessible from the secondary region if a failover occurs. This failover is something that Microsoft handles by changes in DNS, so you don't have to worry about it. But during the failover process, your storage account will not be accessible. If you need your data to be available from the secondary region at all times, you can opt for the ra-grs level. This level will allow for read and write access in the primary region and then read access in that secondary region. With both GRS and ra-grs, your data will be stored 6 times, 3 in the primary region and 3 in the secondary region. Notice that it doesn't say anything about zones with GRS and ra-grs. If you want to be sure you have zone availability as well, there is an additional pair of levels called GZRS and ra-gzrs. As you might guess, these two makes sure to spread your 6 copies of the data across availability zones as well. For all 4 of these geo-redundant levels, the durability of your data is set to 99.169 over a given year, which should be pretty good. But as always, remember to back up your data as well. So now that we've covered some fairly basic parts of Azure, if you want more knowledge on how to build Azure infrastructure from scratch up, I recommend either my playlist on designing Azure, which will set you back less than 45 minutes in total, or my video explaining what all those letters in Azure Virtual Machine sizes and names actually mean. If there's other topics you want me to cover, feel free to mention it down in the comments. Like and subscribe and all that jazz, and yeah, cheers!